people as the traditional owners and custodians of the land in which we meet and pay my respects to others past, present and future. Item one is membership. Membership is as listed in the agenda with Councillor Lawrence on an approved leave of absence and is an apology for this evening. Now, item three is disclosure of conflicts of interest. Are there any disclosures? No. No? Thank you. Item four, confirmation of the minutes of council meetings. It's moved by Councillor Mia and seconded by Councillor Williams. All those in favour? Motion's carried. Before I get to the item five, which is question and submission time, I just wanted to present to Council something, an award that I received recently. I'll just grab it. So at the 10th anniversary of the National Apology, we held an event in partnership with Link Up Victoria and VACA, which we do every year. They, on behalf of both those organisations, Bev Murray and Muriel Bandlett, presented Darwin City Council with recognition of the work that we've been doing in terms of advancing Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander issues within our city, and wanted to recognise our efforts. And this park is, I think, gorgeous, and has Wetherong glass, yeah, they designed it especially for us. Okay, moving now to question and submission time. I'll deal with the questions that we've received online first. So the first question is from Steve Costello from Thornbury. Are you here this evening? And would you like to read out your question? I'll read out the question. When will work begin on providing drinking water taps along the Darwin Creek Park? The response from Council is, this financial year Darwin will be installing four new drinking fountains within its open space network. Unfortunately, none of these will be along the Darwin Creek. The provision of drinking fountains within Darwin, including along the creek corridors, is currently being reviewed through the development of the open space strategy. We expect that this strategy will be completed with this financial year and will guide the installation of future drinking fountains. We will welcome you to provide feedback on the strategy when the consultation opens in the coming weeks. The next question is from Bo Lee, who isn't here, so I'll read out his questions. Will the council be in a position to supply me with 2 to 3 litres of white paint so I can paint the zebra crossing using my own labour and therefore potentially avoiding a fatality at the crossing point? He didn't name the crossing point, but he has raised this issue with us previously, so he's talking about the crossing point on Bell Street and St George's Road on the north, the south-east corner. The response to that question is that following your inquiry from the 20th of November 2017, Council CEO wrote to the Minister for Roads and Road Safety on behalf of our community on 7th of December 2017 to request his support for a safe pedestrian crossing across the slip lane. In response to this letter, Council has been informed that Vic Roads are currently investigating a safe system solution for this site, which may include the installation of signalised pedestrian crossing. It is noted, however, that this is only an investigation at this point and would still be subject to state government funding processes. The next question is from Carolyn Lunch, who is not here at the moment. So I'll read out her question. When will Darwin Council establish a citizens' jury, not the youth citizens' jury, and invite community groups such as the ratepayers group Darwin to be represented on this jury? The response from Council is that Darwin Council is committed to engaging our community in decision-making and feedback to take on new ideas and improve the way we do things. We will explore and implement solution-based engagement methods that suit the various stakeholders and organisations in our active community and diversify and increase community feedback. Recently, community advocacy by local residents and users of Penders Park has seen a fresh new community-led design approach endorsed to create a master plan for Penders Park in Thornbury. We've also had the Arts Hack, which was held in August 2017 on re-envisioning the Darwin Arts Centre, and we're also holding the Aged Care Hack this week on Wednesday. So we're always looking for new ways to engage our community, and we are very open to continuing to engage deliberatively with our community when required. The second question from Carolyn Lunt is, although the planning officers are doing a good job under difficult conditions, when will the council bring a new perspective to the role of planning? The council is deeply committed to continuously improving all of our services, and we understand that planning is an area that would benefit from a constant review. It is also worth noting that planning works within a regulated framework as set out by the state government, so there are some limitations to what can be changed. The next question is from Andrew Barrett from Northcote. Are you here this evening? No, I'll read out this question. Councillor Tim Lawrence's absence from Durham Council is approved, however the duration is indefinite and this prevents Latrobe Board from being fully represented. Good governance and transparency require full council representation. When will a replacement or acting councillor be appointed to fill this vacancy? And the response from council is that Councillor Lawrence is on an approved leave of absence as provided for under the Local Government Act, and there is no provision within the Act to appoint an interim councillor. Andrew Barrett has a second question. Darabin Council News is an important medium by which the community is informed and educated. The Darabin Council currently places the majority of their new notices and advertisements in the Leader, with some placed in the Age and the Herald Sun, with quarterly updates of some items in the community newsletter. Given the at best patchy distribution of the Leader in the Darabin community, will the Darabin Council consider increasing the volume, content, circulation and frequency of output of the community newsletter to include these and other items of interest to the community? And the response from Council is that the Darabin Community News is delivered to all households, libraries, community centres and other Council venues in Darabin bi-monthly. Where possible, Council is open to putting a range of notices and advertisements in the Darabin Community News. However, due to legislative requirements, certain notices must be advertised in newspapers that generally circulate within the municipality and or the state. The regularity, scope and distribution of the Darabin Community News could be expanded, but this would be subject to budget considerations. We evaluate the newsletter regularly, and in general, bi-monthly distribution seems to be well received. Council also has a range of e-newsletters on specific topic areas that you can sign up to via the newsletter subscription page, which is on our website. And we use our website and social media to communicate up-to-date news and events, and you'll find all our media releases in the Media Centre section of our website. If you'd like to, for further information, you can contact our communications manager. Next question is from Mario Politi. I'll read the question. Data members are very concerned about potential death traps of dwellings with fast burning flammable cladding being built in Darabin. We are especially concerned about infill low-rise dwellings that are not required to have sprinkler systems installed and do not have multiple escape options on stories off the ground because they have fixed screening on windows to prevent overlooking. Has Darabin Council, like Yarra and Moreland, carried out an audit of buildings with flammable cladding, including those under 25 metres that do not have sprinkler systems? If yes, where can the public see the data to aid informed decisions about living in or beside potential death traps? If no, why not? The Victorian Building Authority is the lead authority responsible for the audits, inspection and risk mitigation processes regarding the issue with flammable cladding. Similar to Yarra and Moreland, they have completed their audit of Darabin and have identified 48 buildings for further inspection. These buildings were all approved by private surveyors and not by council. Council is awaiting further information from the Victorian Building Authority on how this issue will be managed, including how the level of risk is being assessed and details of what buildings are affected. Council remains concerned about the level of uncertainty, the risks and potential impact that fixing this issue may have on council's limited resources. The next question is from David York, and he's not attending this evening, so I'll leave it out. As a new small business operator, I would like to know when council will beautify the business end of Keon Parade and Johnson Street in Reservoir. With empty shops, graffiti, rubbish odours everywhere, it seems like a forgotten part of council's responsibilities. The residents and local businesses expect more. When can we expect to see improvements, especially for all the new residents moving into the new apartments nearby? Thank you for your question and congratulations on your new venture in Darebin. Darebin is experiencing significant growth, creating competing demands for council funds and works right across the city. Beautification and upgrade works are constantly being implemented across the city in locations prioritised based on a number of factors, including the condition of the centre, infrastructure needs, vibrancy and connectivity. I've asked the CEO to investigate whether the area at Keon Parade and Junction Street is programmed for work in the near future and for staff to contact you directly to discuss this further. Those are all of the questions that we have received online before the meeting. Are there any further questions from the gallery? Anne Labor. We'll just wait to get you a microphone. I'll take that question first and then you can ask your second question. Towards the end of last year, we had a discussion about the frequency of council meetings with the CEO. We were holding meetings every fortnight or twice a month. What we were finding is that there were a limited number of agenda items in the council meeting. We were quite short, particularly for the last two or three months of the year. And so we thought that we would trial, instead of fortnightly meetings, three weekly meetings, so that we can be more efficient when we're here, because it does cost a lot of money each time we hold a council meeting in terms of staff. Council has not taken any decision on the future of our aged care service provision. We are currently working through trying to better understand the needs, the aged care needs of our community. And so we have commissioned a piece of research that has helped us with that. Now that we have that piece of information, we're now going to continue our consultation to better understand the needs of the community before we make any decisions.
Thank you.
Thank you for your question, and I agree with you that we should be saving the trees wherever possible, but I know that on some occasions council needs to remove the trees because they pose a safety risk to the community. In terms of access to the arborist's report, I'll refer that question to the CEO for her consideration in terms of why that hasn't been released and whether we can release it to you after tonight's meeting. Thank you. Are there any further questions? Chris? Okay, I just wanted, in terms of your comments, I just wanted to make a couple of points. In terms of the Preston Market meeting that we had at the Town Hall and the Out Day of MSS, I think that I referred to that evening that the incorporated plan about the Preston Market was outdated. It was 10 years old and that needed to be updated. I don't know that I made any statements in relation to the MSS, which is a little bit different, the different parts of the planning scheme. In terms of the rezoning, I know that the previous council fought it hard for better zoning across Darabin, and it was the planning minister that denied our request, and we have very little neighbourhood residential zones within Darabin, and that was left to the planning minister. So we completely agree with you that we should be better protected. In terms of why is it taking so long to review the MSS, your meeting that you've had in January 2016 was a part of the old council. Since this new council came in, quite early in our term, it must have been early, about a year ago now, we called for a full review of the planning scheme, including the MSS. So we have signalled our desire for that to happen and for that to happen quickly. And there are a number of pieces of work that are currently happening in terms of groundwork to do that, to go through the planning scheme and process. And some, I guess the particular, one of the particular pieces of work that's happening is around the neighbourhood character, around introducing the developer contribution plan, around increasing the subdivision levy, there's a piece of work happening around the Northland Urban Renewal Precinct, and then of course the Preston Market work that we are undertaking with the DPA. So there is a whole lot of things happening in terms of trying to fix our planning scheme. And we very much want to, as I said in my previous comment about citizens' jury, this council is very passionate about making sure that we have genuine consultation with the community and that all voices in the community are heard. So we keep pushing the council officers in terms of the engagement processes that they bring to us to make sure that they're as deliberative as possible. And the CEO is also happy to sit down and meet with you if you have further detailed questions that she can help. Yes. So we recently updated, reviewed our governance local law, which is the rules that we use when we're meeting. It is set around the council meetings, but it also applies to the planning committee. There is provision within the local law for people to request that their opposition to the vote is recorded, but that's all that's possible within the local law. There was a consultation process when we did the revised local law. So it only came into effect September 2017. So there was a consultation process that happened before the adoption of the new local law. And I'm not sure if that was an issue that was raised during that process, but we have to revise the local law and help every... Okay. So the new act, the new Local Government Act will have an impact on the governance local law. So we will have to have another look at local law probably within the next year or two, and so that's something that we could build into it if there is a desire for the community to see that change. So the CEO has just brought up our unsightly properties approach. Do you want to respond to that?
Yep. Through you, Madam Mayor. So with regard to abandoned business on private properties, council's local law, general local law, addresses the issue of unsightly properties. So If there's an issue with the adherence of property and the collection of rubbish and those sorts of things in the front yard, which is the most common way that we see it, that's something that we can do something about, that's provided for in council vote to board. With regard to abandoned vehicles on the street, that's a little bit more complicated here at Darabin. If cars are parked legally and abandoned, then at this moment there's not much that council can do. It's why the law doesn't address abandoned vehicles on the street. If they're parked illegally, we can book them and those sorts of things, but if they're parked in an unrestricted parking area, then there's not much that we can do. Certainly that is something that can be addressed through the local law, and it's something that, in fact, the executive team and I have been discussing with councillors about how we might better manage on-street parking and the impacts of things like abandoned vehicles, because you're right, they are increasing.
Thank you. Are there any further questions? So the CEO is happy to look into that specific example to see what we can do to follow up. Thank you. Are there any further questions? No, thank you everybody. We'll move now to item 6, urgent business. Is there any urgent business? No urgent business. Item 7, petitions. There are 2 petitions to table this evening. I'll go to Councillor Greco.
From residents from Boorock Street. It's in relation to parking issues. So I'll read out the petition. It's signed by 10 signatures. I'd like to thank some of the residents that are here tonight in regards to this petition. The petition reads as follows. We, the undersigned residents of Boorock Street, hereby petition Darabin Council to introduce time parking restrictions in our street. The time and extent of preferred parking restrictions are from 8 a.m. to 4 p.m. on school days between Gertz Avenue and Manol Avenue. This is due to cars parked on both sides of the road blocking access to residents and bus. And if I may add, Mayor, that the petition has been tabled and that a request that it is forward to provide to council in relation to this issue. And if I may also add, that I understand that our officers are already aware of this issue,
mm-hmm.
and there has been some correspondence with some of the residents,
okay.
and that the residents are looking for some sort of facilitation in relation to getting new parking restrictions placed in those particular issues.
Okay, so that's moved by Councillor Greco and a seconder to accept that petition and consider it as general business, seconded by Councillor Rennie. All those in favour? Motion carries. There's a second petition to be tabled.
Through you, Madam Mayor, there's a second petition signed by 16 signatories with regard to Ulmer Grove Norfolk between Prospect Grove and Warley Road. The petition reads, we, the undersigned, oppose the proposed changes to the Ulmer Grove Norfolk. The first point is increase in parking spaces from 24 to 38 via the introduction of angled parking on the north side. The second point is the introduction of pedestrian refuge island at either end of the street. And the third is the proposed new curb out down to the Waterloo Road.
So is there a mover to accept that petition and to have it come back to us at general business next meeting?
Happy to move as per the practice.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. And a seconder? Seconded by Councillor Greco. All those in favour? Motion's carried. Are there any further petitions? No. Moving now to item 8, consideration of reports. 8.1, rates financial hardship policy.
I'm happy to move that, Mayor, but with a slight addition to the recommendation. And
is it going to come up on screen?
It will come up on
screen. Okay. Yes, okay. those changes on to you. We'll just bring up the amended motion onto the screen and then I'll get to make our signature. Can we get the microphone, please? Thank you. Okay, so we have the motion up on screen. There's a mover. Is there a seconder for that? Seconded by Councillor Rennie. Councillor Greco.
Thank you, Mayor. And thank you, Councillor Rennie. I'm happy to move this report and I'm glad that it has come to Council and that it gives Council an opportunity to slightly revamp the strategy. And I think it's quite timely that we re-look at the strategy in relation to hardship cases. How this came about was that there was an internal audit of our the policy, and what was suggested as a result of that internal audit to make the policy much more accessible. Today I requested some information from our officers, and it appears to me that notwithstanding the financial stress that some of our residents are facing, but they may not be fully aware that we do have a hardship policy where payments in relation to rates can be deferred, and also there is a possibility where the interest associated with outstanding rates can be waived in particular circumstances. So this policy then therefore goes towards assisting our residents in cases where they do face financial hardship and that the council can provide them some relief. The relief is of the nature of the way the payments will be deferred. It's not to sort of write off council rates, that's not what's been suggested in this policy, but it's also, what has been suggested in the policy is that payment plans could be entered into, an arrangement of payment plans could be entered into agreement with the residents to pay the outstanding rates over a period of time. Also, what the policy talks about, which I really welcome, is to have a proactive approach in relation to how the policy is being communicated, as I mentioned. I feel that not many residents really fully appreciate that Council has this mechanism to defer payments. And also, what the policy also mentions is to make the application for a deferment of outstanding rates as simple as possible. So that somebody that does come to council with financial difficulty, and it's not an easy thing for people to actually come to council and plead with council in relation to financial problems. So we have to make the system as seamless and as simple as possible, so that if they meet the criteria, that they will be eligible for deferment. And also, what the policy talks about, and I'm glad that this has been mentioned, is that taking legal action on non-payments of the council rate should be a last resort in all cases. And why this is important, and I'll end on this note, is that as we know, in the city of Darabin, property values have skyrocketed. There are people that have been living in the city of Darabin for the last 30, 40, 50, 60 years, and their properties have gone up, and they're on fixed income. And it's important that we provide some relief for them if they are on fixed income or pensions, that they are have the opportunity to defer their payments.
Thank you, Councillor Griffin. Councillor Rennie.
Thank you. I think it's very important that councillors recognise that many people do actually struggle to pay rents, and that may be because they're asset rich and income poor, and people may have purchased properties for $40,000 or $50,000 many years ago. Find today that those properties are worth $1 million. It would be easy to say, well, you know, they're wealthy, they have their properties. But really, when you consider that many people we must collect rates because those rates are essential to the delivery of the services that we all as a community benefit from. And if we can't waive rates for anyone because that just shifts the rate burden onto others. And so this policy which enables deferred payment for people by putting effectively the debt from their rates onto the value of their property, I think meets the needs of those people and ensures that councillors guaranteed the revenue whilst not forcing people out of their homes, which is what could effectively happen if we got litigious and we address this in that way. So I don't actually believe that we're going to be flooded with requests for this because I think most people actually inherently don't want to build debt on their property by not paying their rates. I think it's very important. Most people would much prefer pay the bill when it falls due. And this really, in that scenario, is for those people who simply aren't able to do so, and I think it's a very important service that we can make available to people.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Any further speakers? Councillor McCarthy.
Thank you, Mayor. I'd like to support not only the policy but also the additional point that Councillor Greco added, and I just wanted to draw to Councillor's attention where the policy would be varied as it currently stands. And it's section 3.2 of the policy, point B, which effectively says that ratepayers or the representatives must submit a written application to the revenue coordinator demonstrating financial hardship. So obviously an additional reference there to a resident or ratepayer being able to just simply indicate that they're unable to pay. I think we need to be fair and reasonable, and as Councillor Rennie has pointed out, it's not something that people really wish to do. It is a last resort for most people, and often they're dealing with a range of other financial stresses, and the last thing we want to do is add to that burden, and certainly not creating a burden of proof that is that people would find unreasonable. So I commend Councillor Greco's additional words, and I think we recognise that rates are one of those items in someone's living costs when they own a property, which can sometimes catch them unawares, and we certainly don't want to create a situation where people are having to bear all, in fact, can add to the trauma of that experience. So I commend Councillor Greco on the initiative for those additional needs.
Thank you. Councillor Williams.
This is a huge relief to residents that are struggling financially. We have residents who pay the rates year after year, and they may find themselves without a job at one stage or another, or increasing food costs and bills, or even a medical issue that they may possibly have or bills that they have to pay. This is a huge burden to them. I'd just like to let residents know that we are not debt collectors. We are not people that are like the electricity company or the telephone company. We are actually here and understand that these rates can vary from $800 to $3,000, and that's a huge shock. Just want to let them know that we can ease their burden so they can continue on with whatever they need to do to get back on the path, and we're here to support them in that way.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? So I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? The motion's carried. Next item is 8.2, Rainbow Flag.
Yes, I'd like to move that with a slight addition.
Thank you, Councillor Rennie. Has that been forwarded to the officers to put up on screen? Oh, do you want to read it out?
Yep. So point three would be, firstly, the council, point one as written, point two as written, and three, explore other options for permanently recognising and celebrating our diverse LGBTIQ community.
Can you put that up and I can put it on screen? Is there a seconder? Seconded by Councillor Mia. Councillor Rennie.
Thank you. I'm delighted and proud to be part of a council that has so strongly supported and celebrated the diversity within our community. Diversity that we see in our coal communities, in the strength of people of all ages, and in our LGBTIQ community, which we know, of course, had a very difficult year last year with the marriage equality postal vote. And notwithstanding the great outcome in terms of having achieved marriage equality in this country, I think it's important to note that that was a particularly horrendous year, actually, for many people in our community, and many of those people are still actually feeling the weight of the trauma that was inflicted upon them. So I think our actions are actually part of a picture that has helped to build resilience and faith
in members of our community in the fact that they are valued and celebrated, and that we see our community strengths. This council last year raised the rainbow flag in support of our community. It was a very important and symbolic action. And that flag has flown continuously, with the exception of a few days when other flags have been put up since then. But of course, our motion was to fly the flag until we achieve marriage equality, and we have achieved marriage equality, and it's fantastic that marriages are starting to occur, and isn't that a good thing for everyone? And that raises the question for us, and there's been some discussion, well, what does that mean for the rainbow flag? And I think it would be wrong to deny that there's been some people who would like to see that flag remain, but I think that, in fact, that flag and our actions in raising it really have become very culturally and historically significant in terms of this community. And that's why I commend to you this recommendation, which would see that flag taken down and placed as an object of heritage value into the Darabin Heritage Library collection, with an associated commissioned story that captures and preserves in perpetuity Council's progress and support of the LGBTI community, including this achievement of marriage equality. And alongside that, of course, we can buy a new flag, and we will do that, and raise that flag on days of importance and significance, or during periods of significance to the community. The third point that I've added really responds, I suppose, to many people in the community who want their contribution and the campaign and some of these difficulties recognised in some more permanent way. We don't know what that might look like. We have a reference group made up of community members who can advise us on that, and I think it's important that we go back and think about what could this be, what is the way that we can permanently recognise and celebrate our diverse community. And I look forward to the answers that our community might provide us to that. So I think this is really something to celebrate. I think the coming down of the flag and placing it into a heritage register is an amazing thing to celebrate. Mm. And I think it's important to do because in some ways it's a celebration of our success and a mark of that success, and I think that's really important.
Thank you, Councillor Ring. Councillor
We voted in this chamber in May last year to fly the rainbow flag until we had marriage equality, and at that point it seemed quite a long way away. That decision brought quite a lot of attention to council. We ended up with newspaper articles across Australia and even across to England as well of council making a statement. And I have to say, when I put that motion forward here, I underestimated the importance that that would have to the community. I put this idea forward because I thought it was came from the committee and it was the right thing to do. But some of the stories that I heard made me realise how powerful that, you know, it is a symbol, but how powerful that symbol was. So people saying that, you know, a lot of people in the LGBTI community during that time of the plebiscite feeling scared, feeling unsafe, feeling alone, and then walking down High Street, going to Preston Market or whatever they might be doing, going to the shops, and seeing that flag making them feel a little bit safer and more secure and protected. Another example I heard was of parents talking and saying that, you know, the kids were seeing the flag and it put them in a position where they realised that they hadn't spoken to their children about some of these issues of inequality that exist in the world, that their kids love everyone equally and assume that everyone else does too. So it led to a lot of really good conversations with parents talking to their children about how it's important to keep putting those inclusive values forward or to stand up for what you believe in when you think things are unfair. I was conflicted about whether or not to bring the flag down. Councillor Rennie has successfully convinced me that it is the end of an era, it is a point in time, and while as you say, I think we're still, as a community, reeling from the horrible impacts of the plebiscite, so it still feels like something is happening now and hence not historical. But looking back, I'm sure it will be very important to commemorate this, and this is only the beginning. There's still much more we can do, not just to commemorate, but also to continue to celebrate the community.
Thank you, Councillor Newton. Are there any further speakers? Councillor Newton.
Thank you, Councillor. So following on from Councillor Mayor, I remember the very real impact I realised what we do in the chamber has outside when a Reservoir resident told me how proud they were of Council flying the rainbow flag because their grandson's gay. I also want to acknowledge the strength and courage shown out by our LGBTIQ+ community during the divisive postal survey and acknowledge the way the bulk of our community, queer and otherwise, came to support that community. It was wonderful to see so many houses put out rainbow flags and yes posters, and I think it's one that should be recognised and celebrated for generations to come. I'm very proud council could come out in such strong support of our community in this way, particularly with flying the flag on the Preston Town Hall. I remember feeling a great sense of relief when the result was announced as a yes, and I will always remember celebrating with our local LGBTIQ plus community at Northgate Town Hall that afternoon. Mm-hmm. At our last Sexuality, Sex and Gender Diversity Committee meeting, we talked about our experiences with the postal survey and how it brought up mixed feelings within our community, their families and their community. In particular, committee members talked about how achieving marriage equality is just one step on a journey towards full equality for that community. I want to emphasise that Council is fully committed to working towards full equality for the LGBTIQ plus community. I welcome the Officer's recommendation to place the physical rainbow flag in the Library's Heritage Collection and continue to fly a rainbow flag on three dates. I welcome Councillor Rainey's addition, and I look forward to working with the Sexuality, Sex and Gender Diversity Committee and the local community to work out if and what sort of permanent symbol of marriage equality passing might be good. Thank you.
Thank you. Councillor Williams.
Putting the flag in archives seems a little bit weird considering that we've been fighting for such a long time just to be equal. I would very much like to see a more permanent structure in the public realm of Darebin because I believe this actually speaks louder than words.
Thank you, Councillor Wick. Councillor McCutton.
Thank you, Mayor, and support the additional point by Councillor Rennie. I just wanted to note something which was missing from the report, which is that it's actually, this is our ninth year of flying the rainbow flag in Darebin. And I hate to be the historian on the council, but we actually were one of the first councils to actually do that. And I think we need to recognise the sort of the legacy position that we take in that space. It was in this chamber in 2010 that we had a motion moved by myself and second by Councillor Greco, which was asking us to put up the flag for Idaho Day at that stage. It's now Idaho Hobbit Day. And I think we're capping the word at that stage, yes. The acronym. But what was important at that point in time was we weren't talking about marriage equality, we were actually talking about the inclusiveness of council services and the efforts that we would go to as an organisation to make every council service as inclusive as possible. And that's been part of our story and our journey over 9 years, and obviously our collaboration with a whole range of community organisations based both here in Darebin and beyond, to reform aged care, to reform our libraries, to reform childcare and everything else in between, has led us to the position where we can take those strong advocacy positions in the public sense, because we've been getting and doing what we can to get our house in order. And I would say that we are continuing to push that, because it was only a few years ago that we asked the question, well, it's one thing for us to raise the flag and reform our services, but what else can we do to advance a more inclusive agenda? And the Trans Women Night that occurred just over the weekend is a profound example of that, first in Australia. So this is something we hold dear. It's something our residents, I think, hold dear as well. But I support the action of taking the flag down on this occasion, because the motion that's before us very clearly says, as soon as there is an element of discrimination that council becomes aware of and concerns about, that flag goes up again. And it's sitting there and it's ready to go. And I think that's the commitment we continue to make to our community.
Thank you. Any further speakers? No? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? Motion's carried. Next item, 8.3, endorsement of new members of the Darebin Sexuality, Sex and Gender Diverse Advisory Committee.
Happy to move.
Thank you, Councillor Newton. Did you want to read out the names of those that will be appointed to the committee?
Yes. Thank you, Melissa. So I'd like to move the motion with the following names. 1, Lara Dickinson. 2, Chris Era. 3, Kiri Papetro. And 4, Liam Dooley.
Thank you, Councillor. Is there a seconder for that? Seconded by Councillor Newton.
Thank you, Melissa. I think it's really wonderful that our strong and active sexuality, sex and gender diversity community called for more diversity of gender and sexuality at our last meeting, and for broadening the diversity of this community to better reflect the Darebin community in terms of age, gender, cultural diversity and Aboriginal and Torres Strait Islander heritage, as well as people of all abilities. I'm very proud of what the SSGD committee has been driving and how we're making Darebin a safe and welcoming place for all members of our community. Just last Saturday, we launched the first Trans and Gender Diverse Community Swim Night in Reservoir, which was by all accounts a great success and possibly the first in Australia, with 75 people attending from all across Darebin, Melbourne and as far away as Sale. Writer Quinn Eads said of the event, My kids both very earnestly filled out surveys. My 7-year-old said it was the best time he's ever had at the swimming pool. Having instructors there doing activities was amazing. And then I got to have some grown-up time. My 9-year-old said all gender toilets should be everywhere, not just for special nights. I've never felt so safe in a public swimming pool ever. This is a perfect example of what the SSGG committee can achieve, and I welcome our new 4 members to the committee. I also think it's great that we had 7 people apply, and we wish we could take all of them. Councillor Mia and I, with Mandy and Amelia, and the rest of the officers are looking forward to welcoming Lara, Chris, Kiri and Liam to the committee with our first meeting of the year tomorrow night.
Thank you. Councillor Mia.
So this is a report to welcome 4 new members to the committee to complement the ongoing members. It has been one of the most active committees in regards to bringing a lot of ideas to us here in this chamber, which has been really exciting to support. I wish that we could say yes to everyone who put in an expression of interest, so thank you so much to those committee members who did that. So the selection of these 4 people was based on advice from the officers, and I believe there was a really strong focus on trying to fill some of the gaps in diversity and to bring new perspectives to complement the ongoing committee members. So I'm excited to work with those new members. The role of the committee has been very strong. So the people on the committee bring with them not just their own personal experience, but often representing a group or organisation. And I agree that the swim night held on Saturday was an amazing example. That was a suggestion made by a former member of the committee, Tina Healy, who suggested a number of months ago to see that in action, to see so many smiling faces of people who maybe haven't been able to go swimming for 5 or 10 years or decades because they haven't felt safe. And that is an example of something that, for myself as a cisgendered person, would probably not have occurred to me. And that's why these committees are so important, so that they can identify community needs that are not necessarily visible to councillors, to bring them to our attention so that we can put them into practice.
Thank you, Councillor Mia. Are there any further speakers? No, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? Motion's carried. Item 8.4, Policy and Action Plan for the Elimination of Single-Use Plastic. Moved by Councillor Messina. Seconded by Councillor Williams. Councillor Messina.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Through you, Madam Mayor, I'm happy and excited to endorse the officer's recommendation. First of all, I would like to thank the officers who have completed a comprehensive report and updated councillors on a regular basis. This report has been presented based on the motion I put forth that was endorsed by Council on Monday, June 5th, 2017. We acknowledge that we are a wasteful nation. We are not world leaders in that area of reducing waste to landfill, and I ask why not. So we at Kitgarabin Council led the charge. Stephen Mayne described me as a liberal greenie with a sprinkle of Labour. I guess that makes me an independent, so I will continue to wear the social lens on the council, on all council platforms. The 2 important actions from motion was that 1, council adopts an action plan to eliminate single-use plastic items. 2, we introduce a competition or a meme or a logo for local school children to create an image for the purpose of highlighting the need to change consumer buyer behaviour. Congratulations to Maeve Gunning from Year 6 from the Bell Primary School, who was the overall winner. The elimination of single-use plastic items has significant financial implications on council business, but at what cost is that to our collective evolution? We at Darabin took the lead. The lead, those important resolutions, is about changing the way we at Darabin are doing our business. I'm currently the member of the Strategies and Policy Advisory Group and a member of the MAV Environmental Committee. So yes, I'm passionate about reducing our landfill. It is environmentally and economically an issue of enormous concern. Darabin says no to single-use plastic items. We're getting our own house in order first, but what we know, it is also important to continue to keep an eye on state ban on plastic bags and advocate where needed. It is also important to work with our communities. Let's stop wasteful misuse of resources. Let me draw your attention to Council's plan. Goal number 1, a sustainable city to reduce waste to landfill by 1 kilo per person, not kilometre, sorry. To stop pollution, we need to stop the source. To stop the source, we need to change consumer buyer behaviour. The state government has remained in prehistoric times. This council, the Darabin Council, we need to be the velociraptors, the strategic movers that want change. Here in Victoria, we waited until 18th of October 2017 to ban the plastic bag. We are still waiting the consultation process. Is it antiquated? Well, I think it is. I also draw to your attention the need to increase recycling. Recycling more on a wider range of items. Recycling across Melbourne Metropolitan. I think it's critical to not forget this. Right now, China's national sword policy is hanging over our heads. What should we also be asking is, how is this going to affect us? What would this mean to this council and to the community, both now and in the long term? I believe we need to work smarter to make sure that waste and recycling are sustainable and cost effective, and we should also be working with the industry. In Victoria, in cities across the country, waste issues plague our streets. People continue to dump rubbish and litter, which create health issues, pollute our world waterways and cost council and other bodies expensive monetary expense. We need to drive consumer behaviour and change industry change. As a member of SPAG, did you know that according to the World Economic Forum annual meeting in 2016, if we don't change our behaviours, there'll be more plastic than fish in the ocean in 2050. I guess we'll be eating plastic fish fingers or battered plastic. Plastic is the newest best sauce, so I ask.
Sorry, we're out of time.
Without a straw, bring your own coffee cup, buy baby covers and a little bit.
Thank you, Councillor Messina. Councillor.
I'd like to thank my fellow councillor, Councillor Messina, for bringing this to council. But I'd also like to thank the officers for actually putting the report together and their recommendation. It's a no-brainer. If you love eating seafood and you love going to the beach and you love caring about others, it's time to think about how plastic is harming every little thing. It's time to step up and make the change. It's time to support the cause of banning plastic bags, packaging at microbeats, because change can happen.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? Oh. We've already started the debate and we're supposed to make a submission before we start. I'm sorry. Oh, sorry, I didn't see you. You should have yelled. You yelled at me earlier. Councillor.
Sometimes Councillor Messina is quite right, action is too slow. But I'm a bit of an optimist and I believe that once action starts, things can actually move quite quickly. And I was delighted last week to get the newsletter from my kids' school page, which has devoted a whole page of the online 5-page newsletter to sustainability. And to give you a sense of what they've written, we are delighted to announce that we're ramping up the sustainable practices at the event, finding new ways to make the fete as green as possible. What you can do to help make our fete more sustainable. We're weaning off the bottled water. This year, we're not asking for bottled water donations, we're promoting the use of Melbourne's marvellous tap water. You can help out by bringing your drink bottle on the day. That's a whole lot of plastic that can be avoided. Refuse the straw. Did you know that plastic straws can never fully biodegrade and that they're in the top 10 list of items found on beaches during clean up operations? And so it goes on. And I think the fact that our primary schools, that do not have to listen to a word council says, have taken on this message and are sharing this message with whole school communities. This is 600 kids and all of the parents and all of the thousands of people who come to the fete, is an example of just how fast change can happen once people get the message. And I think that it's absolutely fabulous and I'm very proud to be part of a team with Councillor Messina having moved this motion that is actually contributing to that change, which I think we're going to see happen quite quickly now.
Thank you. Councillor Griffith.
Thank you. I really want to support this motion. I just want to highlight two things because one is that the motion actually talks about essentially about council leading by example. That's what we're doing these days. It's very difficult. You know, we do a lot of advocacy work, but here in this course, I think what it's actually articulated is what we can do in house to actually promote what we're trying to do here. Because it is such a huge thing that we're doing, and I think it will provide a really good example to a lot of other organisations, both in the not-for-profit sector and also in the profit sector, is that if we look at the policy, at the end of the policy, it talks about a two-year transition.
Yep.
Because it's so profound what we're trying to do, we actually require that amount of time for council to actually get its act together. And also for those that may be critical of council going down this path, we do have a clause in the policy that talks about exemptions, and But, and again, that it provides exceptions in exceptional cases, particularly dealing with occupational health and safety matters, and that those exceptions, if applied to, have to be approved by a senior person in the council. Mm-hmm. So we have a few safeguards in there. We have a transition plan in there, and let's get on with it, and let's provide some leadership to the community.
Thank you. Councillor Newton.
Thank you, Minister. So just very briefly, I'm very pleased with Council for leading on this issue of bringing about cultural change. I'm really pleased that our officers are thinking carefully about the ramifications of what this policy means and trialling it to get the best results. I want to commend how much work has gone into this policy to practically look at what's going to work best for the vision we have of a city to achieve behaviour change and reduce use of single-use items. I also commend Councillor Messina for driving this initiative at council level and being so strong with her values on this, and I promise to try to always remember to have my reusable coffee cup all long and
centuries. And all your Instagram pictures are just like, no. Thank you, Councillor Newton. Are there any further speakers? No, if not, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? Motion is carried. Item 8.5, Cliburn Emergency Darabin.
Yes,
Councillor Rennie.
I'd like to move that, and it's just a slight addition of words and the addition of Councillor Trent McCarthy's name, and I think
at point four. Yep.
8.5. Yes, so suggesting that we add into point three a timeline by the first week of April with a view to holding the first meeting in April as per the report, and that we appoint Councillor Trent McCarthy as the Councillor representative.
Thank you, and that's seconded by Councillor Meehan. Councillor Rennie.
Thank you. I've been delighted and really privileged to be part of the interim advisory board for what was the Darabin Energy Foundation. And I think it's worth actually pausing to talk about the change of name and in some respects the change of direction. The Darabin Energy Foundation was an initiative of Councillor Trent McCarthy and supported by all of us, I might say. And over the last few months, we've worked on that concept and really looked at Darabin Council's climate emergency plan and thought about the best response. And it's clear that the response to the climate emergency needs to extend beyond just thinking about energy, and that our climate emergency plan certainly responds way beyond energy. So after much deliberation, the interim advisory board of the Darabin Energy Foundation determined that the most suitable name for the body going forward was Climate Emergency Darabin. We need to put the fact that we're in a state of climate emergency front and centre of what we do, so that people are clear that action is not optional, action is absolutely essential. So the new foundation will facilitate a Darabin Climate think tank to develop local zero emissions and resilience proposals. But importantly, it will harness and encourage community participation and investment and contribute hugely to the delivery of the Darabin Climate Emergency Plan. We have an ambitious plan. I think it's more ambitious than any other that's been delivered across Australia. It's certainly more explicit about the fact that we are in a state of climate emergency. Importantly, this motion notes and commends and congratulates the work, I suppose, of those community members who joined us for the development period over the last few months. And I think many of us felt frustrated at times. We want to see things move fast more quickly, but you have to go through the process and you have to make sure people are on board. And we started with some people thinking they were coming to talk about energy, and they've left 6 months later talking about the climate emergency. And that's a really significant shift, and that's a journey we have to take our community on. And if we can take the community on that journey in 6 months, then we will have achieved an enormous amount. So change often starts in small ways with small groups of people, but it can spread very quickly, and our understanding of that change can spread very quickly. So I think it's really important to note that we need to mobilise our whole community, and we need to activate them, we need to get everybody involved, because the scale of change that we need to undertake is enormous. It deals with that issue of the plastic bags.
10 seconds.
It deals with consumption. It deals with energy use and really how we live our lives, but also how we influence those around us. And we know that our actions here at Darabin have already had influence beyond Darabin and that they will continue to do so. But if we're to have influence, we need to be leaders and we need to walk the talk.
Thank you, Councillor Lennon. Councillor Meehan.
why we're moving into this next stage in the climate emergency. Acknowledge it is quite a different frame to one that's familiar to a lot of people in the community, and so it certainly took me a couple of weeks of thinking to get my head around this shift from the way that we've often heard others talk about climate change, which is, you know, what are some of the things that we can do without having to change too much, or what are some of the things we can do within the parameters of what might be politically palatable, moving away from that to look at how much change do we need to create a safe climate, and what would Darwin do to create, to be the role model, to I suppose put forward and exemplify what the rest of the world would need to be doing to create a safe climate. And that's the thinking behind the climate emergency. We've had these 6 months with the committee, and thanks you to those people who are on the committee. Thanks especially to Phil Sutton, who's in the audience, for his hard work and expertise. We have a lot of people in Darwin who are so passionate about this and are climate experts, some of whom are on the committee. I hope some of them will be joining next committee, which is going to sort of be a bit like an interim board. The vision is that Climate Emergency Darwin will eventually be something that will be separate from council, that will take on a life of its own and put these really big ideas into action alongside a lot of the really great work that council is doing in the climate space. So in these last couple of weeks, we've seen the start of the rollout of the Soil Savers program. We've got hundreds and hundreds of people who have either had visitors or will have visitors in the coming weeks looking at their roofs to put those solar panels on. We've got the changes to the fleet out the back here, and we've got a lot to come, and I hope that we can be successful in bringing the community on board to really make this happen. And thanks very much to Trent for driving this and continuing to carry it forward.
Thank you, Councillor Mayor. Are there further speakers? Councillor McCartney.
Thanks, Mayor, and thanks councillors for recommending me to the new structure which we would be creating this evening. I just want to also acknowledge the work of Philip Sutton, who's joined us here tonight, who of course is a Darwin resident and the author of Climate Code Red, and has invested an enormous amount of time, energy and intellectual capability into our thinking around this. And it's a rare thing when you have members of a council volunteer committee who spend time outside of the committee corralling the troops, doing the research papers, producing an enormous amount of work. It has really moved us along. So thank you so much, Philip, for all your work. And we look forward to your ongoing contributions to the work of Climate Emergency Darwin. It is worth noting that this will become the first, as far as we know, in the world, the first government-sponsored, at least at the local government level, climate emergency organisation. And that is a significant thing to say, because we are now joined by some really positive international collaborators, including the cities of Hoboken, Los Angeles, I'm not sure if anyone's heard of that, and and also the government of Ireland as well, is looking at not necessarily the exact same frame, but something very similar in terms of its investments. So there is a lot of work in this space in terms of shifting how we think about climate from obviously the climate change and climate action frame to the emergency frame, and we as council have taken a very bold position in relation to that. Councillors may be aware that it has now become, I suppose, the next level in terms of thinking about how we need to respond. It's been picked up at the Sustainable Living Festival with a couple of forums there. I'll be at the National Climate Leadership Summit in March talking about this with some others. So we need to continue to advance our strategy, but we also need to get the right people onto this board, and that's certainly what this motion does, and I look forward to seeing who applies for it.
Thank you, Councillor McCarthy. Any further speakers? I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? Motion is carried. Item 8.6, Mayor Park Master Plan Update.
I'll move that, Mayor.
Thank you, Councillor.
I need to include some names, and the Chair of the Mayor Park Master Plan, being Councillor Susan Rennie, with myself as the proxy.
Thank you. Is there a seconder for that? Seconded by Councillor Rennie. Councillor McCarthy.
Thank you. So As councillors would be aware, we have recently undergone with Penders Park a process of setting up a project control group. And it's been great to go through that process because we can now apply a similar approach as we look towards developing the Mayor Park Master Plan. The process that we have here is very similar to what we've already done for Penders, which is to essentially identify a scope of work that a project control group will need to undertake, and they will be community members through a very similar appointment process. We are kicking off that expression of interest process this evening, and as councillors would see from the report, we'll be seeking those expressions of interest so that we can get that process underway. When we talk about the Mayor Park Master Plan, and I draw councillors' attention to the map on page 32, we're really talking about not the Northcote Golf Course, which was originally part of the scoping for this, but just the Mayor Park site. And the site itself has become a beacon of community participation over recent years. It is home, of course, to the outdoor cinema events that are put on by Friends of Mayor Park in collaboration with The Bridge and some other organisations. It's also a place which hosts a number of sporting activities, passive recreation, dog walking, and of course a range of informal activities. It has a lot of potential, not to be the site where we put buildings, but in fact a site to facilitate greater community recreation, celebration of the diversity of the local neighbourhood, and of course a gathering place potentially for other sorts of events and activities into the future. We don't want to just plonk different things in there, but we want to have a holistic vision of the whole site, and that's why developing a master plan, identifying what should go into the park and what shouldn't, is really essential. Council has made commitments around the inclusion of a play space. There has been conversation with the community around community garden, these sorts of events and activities, and of course a rolling series of events throughout the year. But it's really important that we go through a community-led approach to identify what is going to work in that space over time, and how council can invest with the community to make sure that comes about. Importantly, this is the number one piece of green open space for locals in that area, and we don't want to devalue or lose that in any way. There have been proposals in the past to put buildings on top of the oval, and certainly the community made its views known very strongly, and so I suspect that they'll be echoed again through this process. The Mayor Park community, it should be noted as well, is not just the people that live immediately adjacent to the park. It's also a wide range of users from other sports clubs all over Darabin that use that site. So it'll be interesting to see who is interested in being part of this development process, and I'm very pleased to nominate Councillor Susan Rennie to chair the group.
Thank you. Councillor Rennie.
Thank you. I'd like to thank Councillor Trent McCarthy for that nomination, and I'm delighted to accept. And I really look forward to working with our community on the development of this space. Our proximity and access to quality green open space actually has been demonstrated through research to improve the health outcomes of the community. And one thing I found fascinating in those studies was that it doesn't just improve the health outcome of those people who actually use the green open space, it improves the health outcomes of everyone who lives in that area. And I think that's partly because when there is green open space available, it tends to bring people out into the public realm and they connect more with neighbours and with community. And I sort of acknowledge that it would be very easy for council to go away and say, look, you know, this is a first-class playground, piece of playground equipment, why don't we bring this in to this park? And that might be a quick way to go about things. It might even be a slightly cheaper way to go about things. But as much as we'd like to think we always get it right, we know that we don't. And actually, our community and the people who use that park are the experts in what they need and in what will work in that space. And we would be foolish not to draw on that expertise and not to listen to people, because listening to and engaging the community and actually offering them some real decision-making authority within the scope of budget, obviously, and OHS requirements and all of those things, is going to lead to better outcomes for our community. And it's going to lead to better outcomes, not just in relation to the green open space, but in relation to people's sense of agency and community involvement and their sense of engagement with council and with the governance of the place in which they live. And I think that's really important, and those incredibly important benefits that will flow to our community, as well as, of course, whatever fabulous outcome we get from the Mayor Park master planning process and subsequent works.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? I'll put that to that to the vote. All those in favour? Motion's carried. Next item is 8.7, Kenders Park Master Plan, Community Project Control Group.
I'd like to move that, Mayor, and include names in the motion, if I can read those out.
Yep.
We'll just
read the names out first.
Thank you. And this is in...
He's just moving.
Oh no, he's got to read out the rest of the motion.
In no particular order, Melanie Welch, Amy Christensen, Charlotte Hayes, Tony Nick, Mario Fennick, Claire Whitney, Emily Peake and Sophie De Los Santos. So they're eight names to be included in the list there. I think there's eight points.
So is there a seconder for that motion?
Councillor Williams.
Councillor Williams, yeah. You happy to second that? Councillor McCarthy.
Thank you, and thank you, Councillor Williams. It's been a fantastic process, I think, for Council to go through to appoint its first project control group for a community master planning process. And as we just heard the Mayor Park item, we're at the start of a process that will hopefully provide clarity and vision and inclusiveness in terms of that planning process. We're a little bit further ahead with Kenders Park, and that's largely due to the efforts of our community that surrounds Kenders Park, who have been agitating now for well over 18 months to see a number of changes. The first change, of course, that was put on the table was the introduction of an all-abilities and all-ages play space. But that really catalysed the type of conversation that has led to the creation of a project control group, which will comprise those eight community members, myself as the chair and Councillor Rennie as the proxy, and of course the involvement of our officers in support roles. The people that have been appointed are a selection of a much larger group that applied, and I have to say that it was a very difficult decision in terms of the ranking, which was done through a process supported by our officers. Because the skills and qualities and passion of our community for this park and its potential is simply extraordinary. I'm actually staggered by the range of people that have experience in community engagement, in landscape design, in social policy, in a whole range of areas that will really make this group fly, but also representing the various diverse communities that surround Kenders Park. And we need to recognise what this project is about. It's not just a piece of open space. It's actually about creating what will effectively become the backyard for a whole range of kids that will grow up in apartments in that particular pocket of Preston and Gornbury. If you turn your mind just down the road, you've got Preston Junction there, a high concentration of very tall buildings and, of course, no backyards. This is the local park, Kenders Park, for those kids. It's also the local park for a lot of kids in East Preston, in South Preston, in Thornbury. It is a gathering place and it has a rich history. And we need to reflect and respect the heritage of the place, but we also need to recognise that there are things we can do there which are in keeping that heritage, but also make it an even more inclusive and harmonious place. The park itself, I would note, is looked after and cared for by locals, and I would just note that some of our successful members who will be appointed tonight actually go out of their way to collect rubbish around the park. They take an effort to be those neighbourhood watch eyes. And I think we need to recognise that they are exactly the sort of people that need to be part of this conversation. But they'll also be the people that will reach out to other members of the community, because this project control group won't just be making the decisions, they'll actually be leading the process. They'll have a budget and they'll be making sure that a rich range of ideas are brought into the process and that a plan is produced that can be funded by council. So congratulations to all those who will be appointed tonight, and I look forward to working with you.
Thank you. Councillor Williams.
Kenders Park is very close to my heart. There's three generations of my family that actually lived across Kenders Park. I have very fond memories, especially the old tornado slide that used to be there. And I have actually seen it change so many years, probably since the 1950s, I think I wasn't born in 1950. So I've seen photos of it change over the years. I really like to see it go forward and to see the future changes. And I want to also just sincerely thank all the residents who actually wrote into council, who actually wanted to be part of this process, and congratulations to those who will be part of that process, and I really look forward to seeing those changes.
Thank you, Councillor Williams. Are there any further speakers? So I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? Motion is carried. Item 8.8, Digital Transformation Projects, Contract Authorisation for the Integration Platform. Moved by Councillor Mir, seconded by Councillor McCarthy. Councillor Mir.
So the first thing I wanted to flag with this item is to note that this is the first time since I've been on council, in this council term, that we have discussed the authorisation of new contracts openly. Usually it's something that we would do in camera because of the sensitivities around the awarding of contracts. But we've spoken a lot about increasing transparency and accountability, and our CEO, Sue Wilkinson, identified as being a way that we could help to achieve this goal by being open in who we're awarding contracts to and having an open discussion in front of members, and of course being streamed members, residents, and being streamed online as well. So this is the awarding of a contract to develop our new ICT systems. Largely the impact will be for staff who have been struggling with very, very outdated systems for a long time, and this does flow on to having impact for residents. So we're hoping that with this transformation, not only will it make things quicker and easier and more efficient for staff, but the residents will see the benefits too through being able to get quicker and more accurate information, which of course is good for everyone. This is a big project, might take a while, but something that I really really appreciate being on council is that to get really good outcomes, we need to make sure that we have staff who are working efficiently and we can support them to do a really good job. And by fixing up these systems, which I'm sure have been causing many problems for many years, that we are doing that so we can get the best possible outcome for the community.
Thank you. Councillor Cousin.
Just briefly, this is probably one of the most unexciting reports that you ever read in the council chamber, in the sense that it talks a lot about technical things that I don't understand, but it is a very exciting thing for our officers, I know, because it's going to make life easy. But it's actually going to make life easy not just for them, but for the residents and traders that they serve. And I think we need to note that for some aspects of what council does, we are dealing with systems that are decades old, that don't talk to other systems that are decades old or more recent, and that's not a healthy situation to be in when we are doing everything from planning applications to municipal emergency management. We need to have the technology that actually supports good decision making, integrated thinking, but also making sure that we are not sending the same thing to the same household 8 times. I'm not saying that's ever happened, but the challenge for an organisation that has over 100 services and 1,300 staff is that you need to make sure that the computers are talking to each other, and that's really what we're trying to do here. The other thing I just note, and I'm really pleased with this, is that we've gone through a collaborative procurement process, which means that by joining with a number of other councils, including some of our neighbours, we've managed to fetch what we think is the best price for the product that we're looking for, whilst not compromising the quality of what the service that we're going to get. And I think that's really important, because when we go to our community and talk about the investments that we make with their rates in terms of these sorts of pieces of soft infrastructure or technological infrastructure, they want us to know that we've extracted as much value as we can, and that we've sought to see where we can actually leverage our bargaining power, and that's certainly what we've done with these other councils. So I think this is the way of the future for councils, to actually be coming together and procure together. It gives us a lot more bargaining power, and hopefully it means that we can solve some problems together as we go.
Thank you, Councillor Parson. Any Councillor Greco?
Mayor, I just had a few questions in relation to this. Sorry that I didn't raise them earlier, but Councillor's note on page 78 says there's the previous resolution that we passed on the 3rd of July 2017.
Just hang on a sec, Councillor Greco, because we've got different page numbers on the screen. So the resolution from the 3rd of July?
The resolution on the 3rd of July.
Which is page 43 online.
Yep. Which I suppose goes to the heart of what I was trying to say. It talks about people with limited computer literacy skills or people with the English language proficiency is low. And it was a point that we actually made. I remember raising this point in this transition. And what I would like to know is that the potential contractors that we're engaging, what level of expertise do they have in relation to ensuring that we don't leave behind quite a large part of our community? Why I say that is that I know, for example, when the census data shows us that in the northern part of the city there's a lower uptake of internet services. So I just want to get some clarification in relation to that.
Sorry, Ms. Wilkinson?
After you, Madam Mayor, was definitely not an IT expert. I'll have a crack at answering that one. So the contract that we're proposing be awarded tonight is an integration platform. So I've used the analogy previously of a universal result remote. So we have a number of systems that are internal to the organisation but actually keep the lights on in terms of our service to the community that don't speak to one another. So this is about, rather than replacing all of those systems, it's about improving their functionality so that we can then go on and make sure that our community experience a better, more equitable service and we're able to cater to their diverse needs. So this piece of work doesn't specifically do that except to provide capacity for us to do it in other ways.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers to this motion? Councillor Wynne.
I think it's great because this came to council a number of years ago with concerns that it's like having one department not speaking to another. Mm-hmm. And what this actually does, it allows that flexibility that all departments can actually see what's going on one computer system. And it will help resolve any issues with customers or even departments' concerns. At least that things can be easily looked at, rectified on the spot instead of obviously going to a long drawn-out email to try and get answers from other departments and not finding those answers for some time. So hopefully this will actually, yes, there's a cost involved, but it should be, for our officers, it should work out better in the long run because it will make their job a lot more easier and it will make our residents and customers a lot more satisfying because they'll get an answer a lot quicker.
Thank you, Councillor Hume. Are there any further speakers? Can't put that to the vote. All those in favour? That motion is carried. Item 8.9, Road Resurfacing Program 2017-18, and there are five contracts there. CT 2017-231, CT 2017-232, CT 2017-234, CT 2017-235, CT 2017-250 and CT 2017-251. Is there a mover? That's moved by Councillor Rennie. Sorry. Is there a seconder?
Yeah.
Councillor Greco had his hand up, sorry. Councillor Rennie.
This might at first glance seem like an equally exciting item to the last because once again it involves the purchase of a service, in this case resurfacing of our roads. But it is important that we make sure our roads are in good condition because if we let our roads decline and get cracked and get holes in them, then ultimately the whole of the road can need to be rebuilt and that's a very expensive process. So we every year identify roads that are in less than optimal condition and need to be resurfaced to prolong their life and make sure that they're smooth and safe for people to use. And we have quite an evidence-based methodical way of doing that in terms of scanning the road surface and actually giving each road a ranking and making sure that we maintain our roads above that ranking. And I'm really impressed that that's actually the way things happen. It's not because someone rings up and says, you know, I want my road looking like that or like this. It's actually quite a scientific process and I think that's great. So on this occasion, the identified roads have been put out to tender. There was only one person, one company that has tendered for those, and that is Prestige Paving. They are a very reputable service that we have used in the past with excellent standards in OHS and quality, and I think that's very important to note. Whilst as a council it will always be great to see many different providers tender, I think we actually acknowledge as a council also that we are caught up in a state where there is a huge amount of building work going on, a lot of this type of work, a lot of pull for people who do surfaces, who do concrete, who do all of these
these similar kinds of things, and that that does actually reduce the pool. So, as I said, we've used these providers in the past. They've been very effective. They're on the recommended panel, and we're pleased that they're going to be able to get on and do these roads because it's an important part of maintaining the assets of our community.
Thank you, Councillor Rain. Councillor Greco.
Just very quickly, Council has noted that there is slightly the fine print of a legal document, so dense and so boring to do. But what's behind this report is really important. So I think what's behind what we're doing here is in relation to the road resurfacing program that the Council has. And that's very important for the Council because often, as we know, as Councils, we often get calls from residents in relation to a lot of these issues, whether it's a road resurfacing, whether it's a future back roads and things like that. And here it is, in terms of what the Council does, in terms of making sure that we give our road network, the one that is owned by Council, with the proper basis that it actually needs. And it's part of the capital works program that the Council spends a lot of money on. So it may be quite a boring report in terms of the to be. It's actually quite important in setting in motion the contractual relations that the Council needs to make to get work done throughout the year.
Thank you. Councillor McCarthy.
Mayor, I'm obviously support the recommendation, but I just wanted to draw to both councillors and also the gallery's attention how some of the policy settings that we have in the rest of the organisation influence procurement. And I think this is a really great example of that because it's spelled out very clearly on page 51. And if you bear with me, I'm just going to read one paragraph which spells this out, how this actually impacts. The procurement is for the supply and lay of stone mastic asphalt, SMA. The asphalt is designed with a fibre in the mix to allow it to be laid in thinner layers, which reduces the volume of asphalt required and in turn reduces emission of fumes and greenhouse gases and energy savings of up to 30% over traditional hot mixed asphalt. I never thought I'd say the word hot mixed asphalt. Asphalt profiling are taken to recycling stations for reprocessing into materials for later use in new asphalt. Thus, this procurement is set up to minimise the environmental impact of the works. The program aims to improve the condition of road pavement, safety and appearance of the overall streetscape of roads within the municipality. I highlight that because it actually touches on two things that we hear a lot of. What are we doing as a council through every element of procurement and everything else we do to both reinforce the values that we talk about in this chamber a lot around sustainability, reuse, repurposing, and of course delivering a good service, a good amenity and safety to our residents. And in this case, the procurement process does deliver both, and it delivers it, as Councillor Rennie said, in what is a very competitive environment in terms of construction and particularly in the road space as well. So I'm really pleased with this outcome. I think it's the sort of thing which, if we could have it noted for everyone, that these are actually effectively not low carbon roads, but they're reducing the emissions associated through the purchase of the type of product and the supply process. And this is the sort of stuff which I think our residents deserve to know about, not just how much we spend, but also what it means and how we're trying to extract that value wherever we can.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? Councillor Messina, you've got a question?
I have a question. I'd like to know why there is a variance between contingencies from 2.8%, 2.7%, 11.3%, 9.4% and 9%. On page 84 under recommendation. So all four five contracts have a different percentages for constituents.
Yes, I'll ask Mr. Albertini to ask that question.
To ask a question regarding 8.8, which is the digital transformation project.
We've moved on from that one, and we've passed the recommendation, the motion. So maybe perhaps you can take it offline to ask after the meeting.
Thank you.
Is there any other questions on this one?
No.
Okay. Is there any other speaker on item 8.9? No? So I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? The motion is carried. Item 9 is consideration of responses to petitions, notices of motion and general business. There is none. Item 10, notices of motion. There are none. Item 11, reports of standing committees, 11.1, audit committee. That's moved by Councillor Rennie, seconded by Councillor Greco. Councillor Rennie?
Just very briefly, the audit committee obviously meets on a regular basis. The purpose of the audit committee is to turn fine eye and detail onto the accounts of the organisation, but also importantly the management of risk within the organisation. And that management of risk involves both an external auditor and internal auditors. And the role of the internal auditors is to make sure that we have the right systems in place to recognise and deal with risk across the organisation. And I think that's a really important thing, because you can have all the external auditors in the world, but unless they're on the ground looking at the way you do things, they won't necessarily pick up problems. So I think that's probably enough said, and I recommend that the report be received and accepted, adopted.
Thank you. Councillor Greco.
All I would add here is that the role of the internal audit is very, very important for the council. It provides some external and objective analysis of how we perform as a council, and particularly from a governance perspective. We saw earlier tonight the resolution in relation to the hardship policy. That was something that was picked up on the audit committee in terms of making it more accessible. Sometimes when you're very close to the action, it's hard to see where you may be and where the gaps may be. If I had external people to actually have a look at our operations, it enables us to improve the recommended report.
Thank you. Are there any further speakers? No, I'll put that to the vote. All those in favour? Motion is carried. Item 12, records of assemblies of councillors. 12.1, assemblies of councillors held. Thank you. That's moved by Councillor Amir. Is that? Yes?
Yep.
Yeah. And seconded by Councillor Messina. All those in favour? Motion's carried. Item 13, reports by Mayor and councillors. So they should be in front of you there. Moved by Councillor Messina. Seconded by Councillor Rennie. All those in favour? All those in favour? Yep. Did everyone?
Yes.
That's carried. And that brings us to the close of the meeting. Thank you everybody who attended in the gallery this evening. There will be coffee available.